So let's just discuss about metaplastic atrophic gastritis. Metaplastic chronic atrophic gastritis. There are two forms. One is autoimmune, and other is environment related. Okay. So here we are going to discuss about autoimmune metaplastic atrophic gastritis. It is abbreviated as AMAG, autoimmune metaplastic atrophic gastritis. Okay. It is a form of metaplastic chronic gastritis that results in the replacement of the normal oxyntic mucosa in the gastric corpus by atrophic and metaplastic mucosa. Okay. So this is corpus and this is antrum and this is fundus. So mainly changes are seen in fundus and corpus, and there is antral sparing. Antral is involved in H. pylori induced gastritis. Okay. So this is how it differs from autoimmune metaplastic gastritis differs from H. pylori induced gastritis. Okay. So now since I told you that it results in replacement of the normal oxyntic mucosa in the gastric corpus by atrophic and metaplastic mucosa, leading to corpus predominant atrophic gastritis, reduced or absent acid and pepsin production. So reduced acid and pepsin production and loss of intrinsic factor, which may progress to severe form of vitamin B12 deficiency known as pernicious anemia, and it has prevalence of 2% and 0.15 to 1% respectively. So autoimmune atrophic gastritis has prevalence of 2% and pernicious anemia has prevalence of 0.5 to 1%, okay, respectively. And this is T cell mediated destruction of oxyntic mucosa and production of autoantibodies directed against parietal cell antigens and intrinsic factor. So autoantibodies directed against parietal cell antigens and intrinsic factor. Okay. So you should take care of it. So parietal cell antigens and intrinsic factor, and patient may be asymptomatic, but many of them have dyspepsia with postprandial distress. And patients may be symptomatic from vitamin B12 malabsorption and pernicious anemia. The presence of symptoms attributable to anemia depends on the rate that deficiency has developed, the severity of deficiency and hemoglobin level, and the patient's overall health. And patients with B12 deficiency usually have vague or non-specific symptoms like fatigue, irritability, cognitive decline, which are likely to be due to anemia. And B12 deficiency can cause glossitis, including pain, swelling, tenderness, and loss of papillae of tongue. Okay. And B12 deficiency can also cause subtle neurologic, cognitive, and psychiatric changes. And most common neurological manifestation is symmetric paresthesia or numbness and gait problems. So lab abnormalities, what are the lab features? So there may be elevated fasting serum gastrin. So it because of uninhibited gastrin secretion as a consequence of parietal cell atrophy and hypochlorhydria or achlorhydria. And atrophy of zymogenic chief cells in the oxyntic mucosa results in reduction in serum pepsinogen 1. Okay. And iron deficiency anemia may be the most common hematological presentation of autoimmune metaplastic atrophic gastritis and can precede the onset of pernicious anemia by several years. Gastric acid normally enhances the iron solubility and intestinal iron absorption by converting the ferric form of iron to more absorbable ferrous form. And gastric acid also facilitates peptic digestion of dietary proteins bound to iron. Hypochlorhydria, achlorhydria, and reduced peptic activity in autoimmune metaplastic atrophic gastritis decreases bioavailable iron, leading to iron malabsorption and deficiency. And low gastric acid and peptic activity results in liberation of B12 bound to dietary proteins. Also, antibodies to intrinsic factor impair B12 absorption. Okay. And manifestations of B12 deficiency include anemia, macrocytosis, high MCV, elevated methylmalonic acid, pancytopenia, and hypersegmented neutrophils. And patients with AMAG, this is autoimmune metaplastic atrophic gastritis, are at increased risk of development of gastric neuroendocrine tumors, okay, and adenocarcinoma. So they are also at risk for carcinoma as well, okay. And the diagnosis is based on histologic evaluation of the gastric biopsy, which demonstrate atrophy of gastric mucosa with loss of glandular cells, and they are replaced by metaplastic epithelium. So there may be glandular atrophy and intestinal metaplasia and inflammation. Okay, so these are histological changes. And in the advanced stages, the mucosa becomes thin and atrophy. As the name suggests, atrophic. So it becomes, mucosa becomes thin and atrophic. And endoscopy may demonstrate absent gastric rugi in the body and fundus. So it mainly affects body and fundus, that's why absent gastric rugi in the body and fundus, okay. And intestinal metaplasia replaces normal auxiliary glands. Sometimes the mucosa becomes villiform and resembles normal small intestine. So let me write it so that it will become more clear. Intestinal metaplasia replaces normal auxiliary glands. Sometimes the mucosa becomes villiform and resembles normal small intestine. Okay, did you get it or not? So that's what we find on histopathology. And endoscopic surveillance in patients with metaplastic atrophic gastritis is controversial and has not been universally recommended. So recommendations for endoscopic surveillance in patients with metaplastic chronic atrophic gastritis are based on severity of atrophy, extent of metaplasia, and risk factors of gastric cancer. Okay, so in patients with pernicious anemia, an upper endoscopy should be performed to identify prevalent lesions like carcinoid tumors and gastric cancer at the time of diagnosis, and to assess the severity of autoimmune metaplastic atrophic gastritis. Okay, so now let's summarize what so far we have discussed. So the term metaplastic chronic atrophic gastritis, also referred to as gastric atrophy, is used to describe a form of chronic gastritis that, in addition to inflammation, is associated with mucosal thinning, loss of specialized cells in the gastric glands, and changes in epithelial cell types, that is metaplasia. And metaplastic chronic atrophic gastritis includes two main subtypes: autoimmune and environmental metaplastic gastric types. Autoimmune metaplastic atrophic gastritis and environmental metaplastic atrophic gastritis. Although these two may be phylogenetically and clinically distinct, pathogenetically and clinically distinct. They often share histological features and may overlap clinically. So overlap clinically. And autoimmune metaplastic atrophic gastritis is a form of metaplastic atrophic gastritis that results in replacement of the normal oxyntic mucosa in the gastric corpus by atrophic and metaplastic mucosa, leading to corpus predominant atrophic gastritis. Corpus predominant atrophic gastritis. Corpus predominant atrophic gastritis. Reduced or absent acid and pepsin production and loss of intrinsic factor, which may progress to severe form of vitamin B12 deficiency known as pernicious anemia. Pernicious anemia. And laboratory abnormalities include increased gastrin, okay, hypergastrinemia, and iron deficiency anemia, antibodies to parietal cells and intrinsic factor, and vitamin B12 deficiency, okay, and patients have increased risk of gastric neuroendocrine tumors and gastric adenocarcinoma, okay. In contrast to autoimmune metaplastic atrophic gastritis, fasting serum gastrin levels are not markedly elevated in environmental metaplastic atrophic gastritis, and autoantibodies to parietal cells and intrinsic factor and pernicious anemia are absent in environmental metaplastic atrophic gastritis. And diagnosis of metaplastic atrophic gastritis is based on histological evaluation of gastric biopsy, which demonstrates atrophy of the gastric mucosa with loss of glandular cells and their replacement by metaplastic epithelium. So diagnosis is demonstrates atrophy of gastric mucosa. Atrophy of gastric mucosa. Gastric mucosa with loss of glandular cells and their replacement by metaplastic epithelium. Metaplastic epithelium. Okay. And assessment of the severity of gastric atrophy and determining the subtype of chronic atrophic gastritis requires gastric biopsy mapping with adequate number of biopsy from specific sites. And this AMAG is confined to gastric body and fundus, okay, sparing of antrum. And mucosal changes in patients with environmental metaplastic atrophic gastritis affect the body, fundus and antrum in multifocal distribution, but with heaviest involvement of antrum. And serological testing for both anti-intrinsic factor and anti-parietal cell antibodies and fasting gastrin level should be performed as an adjunct to histological diagnosis of autoimmune metaplastic atrophic gastritis. And there is no specific treatment for metaplastic atrophic gastritis. The offending agent, if identified, like H. pylori, should be eliminated as early as possible, and the risk of gastric cancer in patients with metaplastic atrophic gastritis is uncertain and probably does not warrant routine surveillance in patients with mild to moderate atrophy restricted to antrum. And exceptions include patients with advanced stage of atrophic gastritis and those with pernicious anemia. So risk of gastritis in gastric cancer in patients with metaplastic atrophic gastritis is uncertain, and that's why it does not warrant routine surveillance in patients with mild to moderate atrophy restricted to the antrum. And exceptions include patients with advanced stage of atrophic gastritis and those with pernicious anemia. So those should be evaluated because there is increased risk of cancer, okay? So if you want to take note, you can take it.